My dear General Muhammad Zahir Ul-Islam, dear members, leaders, and members of the Center for Global and Strategic Studies, dear participants, ladies and gentlemen. The SCO still has tremendous challenges in military political sphere, especially in the last several years. It will confront with tremendous challenges in the future, in the long run. Three major military strategies recently stamped by this Trump administration, they are here, directly target national security of some SCO states and the SCO as a whole. In general terms, the SCO is confronted with the Cold War 2.0, second version, which has been imposed by the key Western community actors headed by the United States. In particular, the most acute challenge the SCO is facing now is that two of its original members, namely Russia and the PRC, have been labeled as long-standing strategic competitors of the United States and revisionist states, though both powers have defensive nuclear doctrines than the United States and have never threatened the American people and will never threaten in the future, I believe. During 5 years, the USA is going to allocate $3.6 trillion in military budget with a great emphasis made to contain the PRC and Russia. The Islamic Republic of Pakistan, as a SCO full-fledged member, is also under constant pressure from the United States for alleged offering safe havens to terrorists. Strange to hear such claims, because it is namely Pakistan who made a formidable contribution to wipe out the menace of terror. Over the past 3 years, the number of terrorists in the country has declined by 2/3. Moscow is very grateful to Islamabad for such tireless contribution to blow the terrorist activity. Later this year, Russia and Pakistan will conduct anti-terrorist exercises that are essential in combating terrorism. In general terms, Russia is happy that its relationship with Pakistan are developing very actively and promptly along all directions, and we, on our behalf, are ready to follow this road. Iran has been arbitrarily characterized as a developer of the ballistic missile system and having nuclear ambitions, and as a terrorist-sponsored state. The idea of Washington to reconsider the Vienna nuclear deal with Tehran can lead to an arms race in the region. New national security strategy of the United States says that the U.S. would create new coalitions to consolidate success in Afghanistan. But what kind of success if there is no ground for success? During Trump's predecessor time, Barack Obama failed to maintain tranquility in Afghanistan, having 100,000 troops, for example, in 2011. Donald Trump is going to increase the overall number of American and allied forces in that country up to 29,000 troops. But these steps will extend the U.S. interference in Afghanistan. There will be no peace. Unfortunately, resistance and war and long, long list of casualties of civilian population. Though North Korea is not a CSCO member, but a very strong military pressure from Washington against Pyongyang will have two negative repercussions for many SCO member states. The recent US NPR nuclear posture review that has reaffirmed that North Korean nuclear program must be completely and irreversibly eliminated by using all means, nuclear means. The same notion has been reiterated by the U.S. delegation at the recently held Munich Security Conference. The USA is going to set its firm military and political foot in the Central Asia for its indispensable geopolitical gains over another group of the SCO member states. The U.S. new national defense strategy openly sets a task to the United States Armed Forces to contain aggression in three key areas. First, Indo-Pacific, which is wider than Asia-Pacific. Second, in the Middle East, and third, in Europe. By the way, I would like to share with you quite a terrific figure suggested by American scholars. After proclamation of independence by the United States a long time ago, it intervened in domestic affairs of other countries 563 times. In average, two times a year, more than two times a year, 563. And this intervention will continue. Washington still is taking part in disrupting the process of national reconciliation process in Syria and recreate new, so to say, Islamic State type terrorist armed structures with the aim to topple the legitimate regime in Damascus and to dismember the country. At the end of my PowerPoint presentation, I just recently added the fresh map of the political situation in Syria, and if you ask me a question, I could briefly just make some remarks. It clearly shows that Americans have not been invited to that country, but they are still there. They illegally enforced a no-fly zone in certain area and created several military installations and bases in Syria. There are several other challenges stemming from outside the SCO adjacent zones of vital national security interests, both in nuclear and in non-nuclear area. America would like to make a transformation of the U.S. nuclear strategy. It will be much tougher than that of nuclear strategies stemmed by Trump's predecessors. So the list of key differences are here. So the first nuclear weapon clause, use of nuclear weapons clause, it has been retained, but it lowers the threshold of utilizing nuclear weapons even under the pretext of technological surprises. Who could tell me about that? What kind of technological surprises? Etc. So it has a deeply rooted on unconditional offensive nuclear deterrence. That's not the name of the game borrowed from NPR. That's our assessment. Four short words describing the essence, the heart of the newly born American doctrine. So, strategic balance of forces between the USA and Russia are on this chart. These are new start limits on the left column, then USA, then Russia. Approximately, we are equal in terms of warheads and delivery systems. But geographically, Russia is in disadvantaged position because Americans have, so to say, forward-based nuclear capabilities stored and deployed very close to our shores. As I said earlier, they would like to resort to limited nuclear strike using low-yield nuclear warheads. This is a sample of a testing device of a B-6112 nuclear bomb. It will have such types of nuclear charges. The lowest is 0.3 kiloton, etc., etc. By the way, in Russia's expert community, we believe that low-yield American nuclear warheads are those warheads that are less than Hiroshima atomic bomb American dropped on Hiroshima. It was 15 kilotons. So, first three up to 50 kiloton is excluded, could be referred to as low-yield nuclear warheads. Next slide. The U.S. strategic triad will be created from 2025 to 2080 plus, involving totally new three legs of the strategic nuclear triad. I will not read it. You will see it by yourself. So it is tremendous asset. Tremendous asset also. By the way, Russia's view, the U.S. plans to develop new low-yield nuclear weapons will greatly increase the temptation of using them, especially considering the right to a disarming first strike as set out in the new U.S. doctrine. Moscow believes that this dramatic lowering of the threshold conditions can provoke a nuclear missile war even in a low intensity conflict. Unfortunately, the U.S. president have exclusive and unilateral power to use nuclear weapons at his own discretion, bypassing the Congress, defense and state secretaries, supreme judge, whatnot. That's why this issue attracted attention by two chambers of the U.S. Congress and irrespective of political affiliations. In a draft resolution, the restricting first use of nuclear weapons of 2017, introduced in both chambers, lawmakers just persuaded the president and future presidents of the United States never to use nuclear weapons first without authorization of Congress and without a declaration of war to any nation. I would like to say that potential memorandum of U.S. president to use nuclear weapons can reach strategic offensive nuclear arms within 3 to 5 minutes, and after that, the USA can deliver first nuclear strike from 3 to 12 minutes time. So it's a very short period to react. I would like to add in this particular context that after 1945, when Americans used nuclear bombs against Japan, the U.S. has planned to use nuclear weapons 7 times in 5 regional conflicts and in 2 great power confrontations. Thanks God they have not used it, but they are going to use. This kind of formula borrowed from the U.S. Congress concerning the right of the President of the United States to use nuclear weapons as a first strike capability. The United States is violating the INF Treaty. We signed, the Soviet Union signed with the United States in 1987. And the figure is 93 violations versus zero from the Russian side without withdrawal from the treaty. Americans de facto violating it. So it's also a kind of unfortunate event. Well, there are some other non-nuclear factors in today's and future world. Ballistic missile defense, figure on the left in the box, 1538, it's only strategic interceptors. Patriots are not included. Here on the right side, 1826, USA plus Asia-Pacific friends and allies, non-NATO members. So it's a tremendous asset. And when the formula is reached 2-to-1 or 3-to-1 in favor of interceptors, if compared with the rest of nuclear warheads, that will be the end of global stability on our planet. And in the plain text, I made some detailed explanation what does it mean 1538, etc., by structured. Second challenge, the new the Chicago Triad. It's a combination of nuclear weapons, conventional forces, and ballistic missile defense. After Chicago summit on 2012, there was a diet, old diet, now has gone. It's the Chicago Triad. It's also moved very closely to Asia-Pacific countries and from Europe to us and to our friends. And the third challenge still continues. Its interference, I said, into domestic affairs of the SCO members, and no desire from Washington to resolve potential militarization of outer space. Has turned down 20 positive proposals, almost all of them, from the cosmic age, outer space age. And current U.S. national security strategy has openly proclaimed U.S. leadership and freedom of action in space, even bypassing the rest of the transatlantic alliance. Final brushes, practical suggestions. The SCO has very broad and multifaceted opportunities to overcome this and other imminent challenges. Preserving the unity and cohesion inside the organization is a crucial factor to go down this road. The interoperability between carefully crafted ideas and solutions has to be encouraged and circulated on an equal footing of all its member states and participants. Without converting the SCO into a military alliance at this particular juncture, there should be a frank and friendly discussion of the current global developments in military political sphere and in the arms control domain at a specially convened meeting at the level of SCO defense and foreign ministers. Russia is still committed to transfer the regional anti-terror structure into the center for combating new challenges and threats. So to move beyond anti-terrorist activity. Optionally, the Security Cooperation Coordination Committee might be brought about with a mandate to coordinate military and military technical cooperation in the SCO framework. In order to enhance regional security, the SCO peacekeeping units have to be created on ad hoc basis for our own purposes. It is expedient to set up a special national military advisors group inside the SCO with a mandate to elaborate recommendations in the security area. Moscow is in favor of the implementation of the notion to create the new security issues prognosis or forecasting center. The great asset of the SCO is that all its members are independent nations. The SCO doesn't have any leading nation or any backbencher state. They have their own opinion to share individually and together as an organization. Their voices have already been heard everywhere. This practice should continue. Two final words. No doubt the multifaceted and amplified voice of the SCO and military political domain and in the arms control will be more effective if it is delivered openly and straightforwardly to the world community on behalf of the entire organization. Their special stance as to how to avoid potential blundering into a disaster in military sphere on the global scale should be delivered at this crucial juncture. It's near my home place, but it's not a Cold War. But the SCO has not initiated the Cold War second option and doesn't want it to continue. And it is the map I borrowed from newspaper Komsomolskaya Pravda, but later on I will not just use your valuable time afterwards when we talk about Syria during interpolation session, question and answer session. So I'm very grateful for your passion, for your attention. Thank you very much. And I'm looking forward to hearing any of your questions related to the main subject of my remarks or beyond its scope. Thank you very much indeed. Shukran.